The Haystack in the Floods by William Morris. Read by Nick Gisburne. Had she come all the way for this, to part at last without a kiss? Yea, had she borne the dirt and rain, that her own eyes might see him slain, beside the haystack in the floods? Along the dripping leafless woods, the stirrup touching either shoe, she rode astride as troopers do, with kirtle kilted to her knee, to which the mud splashed wretchedly, and the wet dripped from every tree upon her head and heavy hair, and on her eyelids broad and fair. The tears and rain ran down her face. By fits and starts they rode apace, and very often was his place far off from her. He had to ride ahead to see what might betide when the roads crossed, and sometimes when there rose a murmuring from his men, had to turn back with promises. Ah me, she had but little ease, and often for pure doubt and dread she sobbed, made giddy in the head by the swift riding, while for cold her slender fingers scarce could hold the wet reins. Yea, and scarcely too she felt the foot within her shoe against the stirrup. All for this, to part at last without a kiss, beside the haystack in the floods. For when they neared that old soaked hay, they saw across the only way that Judas, Godmar, and the three red-running lions dismally grinned from his pennon, under which in one straight line along the ditch they counted 30 heads. So then, while Robert turned round to his men, she saw at once the wretched end, and stooping down, tried hard to rend her coif the wrong way from her head, and hid her eyes. While Robert said, "Nay, love, 'tis scarcely 2 to 1. At Poitiers, where we made them run so fast, why, sweet my love, good cheer, the Gascon frontier is so near, naught after this." "But oh," she said, my God, I have to tread the long way back without you. Then the court at Paris, those 6 men, the gratings of the Châtelet, the swift Seine on some rainy day like this, and people standing by and laughing, while my weak hands try to recollect how strong men swim. All this, or else a life with him, for which I should be damned at last. Would God that this next hour were past." He answered not, but cried his cry, "Sent George for Marny," cheerily, and laid his hand upon her rein. Alas, no man of all his train gave back that cheery cry again. And while for rage his thumb beat fast upon his sword hilts, someone cast about his neck a kerchief long and bound him. Then they went along to Godmar, who said, "Now, Jehane, your lover's life is on the wane so fast that if this very hour you yield not as my paramour, he will not see the rain leave off. Nay, keep your tongue from gibe or scoff, Sir Robert, or I slay you now." She laid her hand upon her brow, then gazed upon the palm as though she thought her forehead bled, and, "No," she said, and turned her head away, as there were nothing else to say, and everything were settled. Red grew Godmar's face from chin to head. "Jehane, on yonder hill there stands my castle, guarding well my lands. What hinders me from taking you, and doing that I lust to do, to your fair wilful body while your knight lies dead?" A wicked smile wrinkled her face. Her lips grew thin. A long way out she thrust her chin. "You know that I would strangle you while you were sleeping, or bite through your throat, by God's help, ah!" she said. "Lord Jesus, pity your poor maid, for in such wise they hem me in. I cannot choose but sin and sin, whatever happens. Yet I think they could not make me eat or drink, and so should I just reach my rest. Nay, if you do not my behest, O Jehane, though I love you well," said Godmar, "would I fail to tell all that I know?" "Foul lies," she said. "Eh? Lies, my Jehane? By God's head, at Paris folks would deem them true. Do you know, Jehane, they cry for you? Jehane the brown, Jehane the brown, give us Jehane to burn or drown. Gag me, Robert, sweet my friend, this were indeed a piteous end for those long fingers and long feet, and long neck and smooth shoulders sweet, an end that few men would forget that saw it. So, an hour yet. Consider, Jehane, which to take, of life or death. So, scarce awake, dismounting did she leave that place, and totter some yards, with her face turned upward to the sky she lay, her head on a wet heap of hay, and fell asleep. And while she slept, and did not dream, the minutes crept round to the 12 again. But she, being waked at last, sighed quietly, and strangely childlike came and said, I will not. Straightway Godmar's head, as though it hung on strong wires, turned most sharply round, and his face burned. For Robert, both his eyes were dry, he could not weep, but gloomily he seemed to watch the rain. Yea, too, his lips were firm. He tried once more to touch her lips. She reached out, sore and vain desire so tortured them, the poor grey lips, and now the hem of his sleeve brushed them. With a start, up Godmar rose, thrust them apart. From Robert's throat he loosed the bands of silk and mail, with empty hands held out. She stood and gazed, and saw the long bright blade without a flaw glide out from Godmar's sheath, his hand in Robert's hair. She saw him bend back Robert's head. She saw him send the thin steel down. The blow told well. Right backward the knight Robert fell, and moaned as dogs do, being half dead, unwitting as I deem. So then Godmar turned grinning to his men, who ran some 5 or 6, and beat his head to pieces at their feet. Then Godmar turned again and said, So, Jehane, the first fit is red. Take note, my lady, that your way lies backward to the Châtelet. She shook her head and gazed a while at her cold hands with a rueful smile, as though this thing had made her mad. This was the parting that they had beside the haystack in the floods.